Hello, I'm Dr. Dennis McKenna. As always, I'm joined by Dr. Fred Venditti, our Hospital System General Director. Today is Tuesday, January 26th, giving you the update from Albany Med. All right, Fred, today we have five graphs.
We do.
Five.
Yes.
So we know the first.
A lot of information.
We know the first graph. This is Capital Region, eight counties. A little hard to see, but some very good news here. So when we had the highest number of people admitted to the hospitals in the Capital Region, we were at 553. Today, that graph shows 503.
That's right.
And you have some information about tomorrow.
That's right. So 10% reduction on the graph, and then we've gone down further on our regional call this morning.
Great.
Another 2% drop.
Fantastic.
Yep.
Next graph is admissions and discharges here to the medical center. Similar story. As many as 15 a day a couple weeks ago. We're hovering the range now where admissions per day is probably in the 5 to 7 range.
That's right.
With often an equal or greater number of discharges.
That's right.
And as we say, still no influenza activity to speak of. And then here's the morning census here at the medical center. So currently 135 in the hospital. 23, Fred, in the ICU, and 6 of them are on ventilators.
That's right, Dennis. So again, those numbers, the unit numbers are kind of stable, but we are starting to see a slight drop in our total.
And you've often talked about this, that first you see an increase in positive in the county, then you see an increase in positives in the hospital, then positives in the ICU and on ventilators. So we're just watching those numbers.
It's remarkable how it keeps playing out that way.
Right. Now, Fred, you had two other graphs you wanted to talk about. So there's national numbers and state numbers.
Right, Dennis. So this first graph is from the COVID tracking project, which is the national numbers. It's a 7-day moving average of cases in the red line. And you can see that's started to drop really a couple of weeks now. And then the blue line, which are hospitalizations. And that has been following
right
now in a downward fashion. The peak hospitalization countrywide was January 6th at about 132,000.
Okay, very
so
good.
So that's good. The next graph here is New York State. So it's the same color scheme. The red is cases, and again, we have a peak, and we're coming off that peak. And the blue is hospitalizations, and it looks like it's plateaued, and it's just beginning to start its downward slope, which is very good.
We know on this campus here, if you get admitted to the hospital and you have COVID, you spend an average of 15 days in the hospital.
That's right, Dennis.
Which means that, you know, when we see the admission numbers go up like we did, even if we stop admitting as many people as we have in the past, it takes a while for those numbers to come down.
That's right.
And when they come down, we hope that the trend continues. In those five graphs, all good news.
All good news.
We were certainly calling it as it was going up. I think it's good news that it seems at this point at least to be heading down.
So your point about length of stay, so here's my prediction. We're going to kind of hover in the 130s for most of this week. Next week we'll start to see a reasonably significant decline in census.
I agree with that. I agree with that. Fred, we've often talked in the past about the tier level, and this has to do with how many beds we have, whether they're staffed. Obviously, when we got up to the level of 5, that was pretty significantly high.
Right.
People are familiar with that. Med-surg beds, what tier are we at?
Level 4.
Level 4. And ICUs?
Level 2.
Level 2. All right. So let's talk about that. So in the ICU area, one of the things that you led us through is you increased our ICU beds by converting non-traditional spaces into ICU areas, like the PACU.
That's right. So the C-basement PACU, we converted into what we call a clean ICU, so not COVID patients.
And we are calling that the PACU ICU.
Correct.
Staff with ICU nurses, staff with ICU doctors, ICU care being delivered.
That's right.
Is that something we're going to have to continue to do for the next few weeks?
So Dennis, I think we're on the cusp of shutting it down. So we're going to hear at 3 o'clock at our incident command meeting, probably a recommendation that we think we can back away from that and still meet the needs of our community.
And so if we were to do that, what would we do with the staff who are currently working in the PACU ICU?
So many of the staff in there are critical care trained nurses who work either in the other PACU
right
that we have here in the hospital or VIR or elsewhere around the organization. So we'll begin to move them back to their home sites as we make these changes.
So in the beginning, we've called this strategic redeployment.
Correct.
You take people with skill sets, you move them from one part of the hospital to another part of the hospital, And so we could potentially call this strategic redeployment. So we'll take them and move them to a different part of the hospital or potentially back to their home base.
And, you know, Dennis, let me say this. You know, this has not been easy for our staff. I think it's important for us to acknowledge that. I've received some emails from some folks who've done this for us that are kind of distressed by this. And all I can say is, you know, there's heartfelt appreciation on my part, and I'm sure your part for what they've done. It's been important to the organization. It's been important to our patients and our community. We didn't make this decision lightly.
Right.
It was very considered. It was the best bad choice we had. And now, fortunately, we're probably at the beginning of being able to unwind it. Thank you.
No, I agree, Fred, and I thank you, too. And I don't think you could have said it any better. And it has been a series of difficult choices.
Absolutely.
But it's allowed us to continue to meet our mission. And it also shows that every decision that's made is reevaluated frequently.
That's right.
All right, very good. Fred, let's talk a little bit about another positive number we're seeing. We had a day a couple weeks ago where we had, I want to say, was it 38?
38.
38 was the number of members of our workforce who tested positive for COVID. By and large, when our epidemiology team looked at this, we believe contracted in the community.
Yes.
Okay. In the last 3 days, the number each day that's tested positive is?
Two. Each of the 3 days.
So six over the last 3 days as compared to 38 in one day.
That's right.
Another interesting statistic is of the six who tested positive, which by the way represents about 3% of the people that were tested.
That's right.
How many of them are fully vaccinated?
None of them.
None, right? In fact, none of them have even received the vaccine yet.
That's right.
So there are a couple reasons why we have members of our workforce who have not been vaccinated. Let's start by mentioning that 85% of our workforce has been vaccinated.
That's absolutely fantastic.
It is a very high number, and we want to go higher.
We do.
And as more vaccine becomes available to us, we will schedule more opportunities for people to be vaccinated. There have been some, Fred, who've been a little bit hesitant to get it, and you and I have both received emails.
Yes.
And some people have been actually more concerned about the second vaccine because they've heard from people who say, I know someone who got the second dose, they got sick, they had some chills, they may have had a low-grade fever. I'm worried about getting it. And we've told them
they should still get it.
Right.
And Dennis, in the data that was given to the FDA, there is a higher incidence of some of those side effects, fever in particular, after the second dose, which probably indicates that your immune system is starting to kick in. So no one's been incapacitated, you know, in a very, very severe way by this. We have had some staff who had to stay home because of fevers, but it goes away in a day or two, and then you're back to sort of your normal self. So don't avoid the second dose for fear of side effects.
Great message. And again, very encouraging news. Very few numbers testing positive now, and when they do, they're the unvaccinated. So getting vaccinated would appear to protect against
it. I think it makes a huge difference then.
Yeah, for sure. All right, couple things we want to end on. First of all, Fred, there were some... we talked recently about some quality awards that have been given out. One area is health grades, which is a way which clinical programs are measured, the top 100 programs in the nation.
That's right.
And we talked about the spine program here, which was recognized for spine surgery as one of the top 100 in the country. And there are two others that we want to add to that list.
That's right, Dennis. So sticking with orthopedics, joint replacement also is a best 100 program in America here at the medical center, and prostate surgery.
Great.
Again, best 100 in the United States. So congratulations to both of those programs.
Great programs. I think I was saying to you before, my mother has had both of her hips done here.
There you go.
The bionic woman, right? So great programs. Congratulations to them both. Finally, Fred, we have three missions here. We always talk about them: academic, research, and clinical care. Our academic mission is something we're incredibly proud of. Two things that we want to highlight. Number one, Journal Club. That's something that was going on in the beginning of the pandemic remotely.
That's right.
Members not only here, but in the community who are participating, and I think they're going to kick that off again.
That's great. You know, I mean, it really makes our medical students shine when you listen to them, the work they've done to create those journal clubs. Really fantastic.
And great support from our faculty. So we look forward to updating on that in the near future. And then speaking of journal club, journal club in the past was supported very aggressively by our Schaefer Library staff.
That's right.
They would go, they would pull articles, they would help make them available to the people presenting Journal Club under the leadership of Enid Geyer. And Enid watches the videos, and she's actually done something recently which we think is noteworthy related to
this. Yes. So periodically, we talk about articles that we've seen that we think are relevant for the viewers to know about.
Right.
Enid has begun to put them on the website of, of the library so people can read those articles for themselves, which is really fantastic.
It is fantastic. And we said if anybody wants to submit one, right?
Yes. So if there's an article out there you've read that you'd like us to talk about, send one of us or both of us an email, and we'll be happy to do that. You know, it's important to share information, data.
Absolutely.
Factual information. And that's part of what we've done with these videos. That's so important to all of you.
Very good. All right. Very good. So a lot of good news today, a lot of good data, a lot of promising data, all really moving in the right direction. So, and some great quality work on this campus. We'll be back again on Thursday. I think that's two days from now. So we'll see you then. We ask that you once again, please take care of yourself, take care of each other, and we'll see you in 2 days.